ॐ गणानान्त्वा गणपतिगुं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनशृण्वन् नोतिभिः सीदसाधनम् प्रणो देवी सरस्वती वाजेभिर्वाजिनीवती धीनामवित्र्यवतु गणेशाय नमः सरस्वत्यै नमः श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ यश्चन्दसां ऋषभो विश्वरूपः छन्दोभ्योऽध्यमृतासं बभूव समेन्द्रो मेधया शृणोतु अमृतस्य देवधारणो भूयासं शरीरं मे विचर्षणं जिह्वा मे मधुमत्तमा कर्णाभ्यां हूरिविश्रुवम् ब्रह्मण कोशोऽसि मेधया पिहितः श्रुतं मे गोपाय ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः मेधा देवी जुषमाणा न आगाद् विश्वाचि भद्रा सुमनस्य माना त्वया जुष्टानुदमाना दुरुक्तान् बृहद्वदेव विदथे सुवीराः त्वया जुष्टऋषिर्भवति देवि त्वया ब्रह्मा गतश्रीरुतत्वया त्वया जुष्टश्चित्रं विन्दते वसुसानो जुषस्वत्र विनो न मेधे मेधां महीन्द्रो ददातु मेधां देवी सरस्वती मेधां मे अश्विना बुभावाधत्तां पुष्करस्रजा अप्सरा शुचया मेधा गन्धर्वेषु चयन्मनः दैवी मेधा सरस्वती सामा मेधा सुरभिर्जुषता स्वाहा आमा मेधा सुरभिर्विश्वरूपा हिरण्यवर्णा जगति जगम्या ऊर्जस्वती पयसा बिन्वमाना सामा मेधा सुप्रतीका जुषन्तां मयि मेधां मयि प्रजां मय्यग्निस्तेजो दधातु मयि मेधां मयि प्रजां मयीन्द्र इन्द्रियं दधातु मयि मेधां मयि प्रजां मयि सूर्यो भ्राजो दधातु हंस हंसाय विद्महे परमहंसाय धीमहि तन्नो हंसः प्रचोदयात् ॐ साईश्वराय विद्महे सत्यदेवाय धीमहि तन्नः सर्वः प्रचोदयात् स्वस्ति प्रजाभ्यः परिपालयन्ताम् न्यायेन मार्गेण महीं महिषाः गोब्राह्मणेभ्यः शुभमस्तु नित्यम् समस्तलोकाः सुखिनो भवन्तु समस्तलोकाः सुखिनो भवन्तु समस्तलोकाः सुखिनो भवन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
ॐ नमो व्रातपतये नमो गणपतये नमः प्रमथपतये नमस्ते अस्तु लंबोदरा एकदन्ताय विघ्ननाशिने शिवसुताय वरदमूर्तये नमः। ओम श्री साई राम। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ all the enthusiastic seekers of Vedic knowledge in the form of dedicated resource persons, sincere Vedic learners, and all the brothers and sisters who are verily the integral part of Sri Satya Sai Samyukta Shruti Shreni of Sri Satya Sai Seva Organization, I offer our loving pranams at the lotus feet of Vedamata Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba. I am indeed highly privileged to welcome you all to this third episode of Gama Agama lecture series. Today we have with us Brother Professor Shivashankar Sai, a pious, humble, devout and a blessed soul who has exemplified himself in all respects as an ideal Sai student, as an ideal Sai Sevak, to address us on the topic lessons from Upanishadic stories. Few words about Brother Shivashankar Sai. Professor Shivashankar Sai was born in a Sai family. He first came to Bhagwan Baba as a Balvika student in 1972. He joined Swami's College at Brindavan, Bangalore for his pre-university course in 1976. He subsequently completed his BSc, MSc and received his PhD in fiber optic sensors from the divine hands of our beloved Lord in 1989. Post his education, Swami blessed him to be a faculty member as a lecturer in 1990 at Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning. Swami blessed him by making him as a warden of Senior Boys Hostel in 1994, which he continued till 2011. Besides being the warden, Professor Shivashankar Sai held several senior positions in Swami's university, such as head of the Department of Physics, followed by Dean of Sciences during 2014 and 17, and the director of Prashanthi Nilayam campus during 2018-20. He is currently the convener of the research facility in Prashanthi Nilayam campus called as Central Research Instruments Facility. With these few words, I extend once again a warm welcome to Professor Shivashankar Sai to address us on this great topic on Upanishadic stories. Professor Shivashankar Sai, Sai Ram.
ॐ गणेशाय नमः सरस्वत्यै नमः श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ यथा वृक्षस्य सम्पुष्पितस्य दूराद् गन्धो वा आत्येवं पुण्यस्य कर्मणो दूराद् गन्धो वाति अणोरणीयान् महतो महीयानात्मा गुहायान्निहितोऽस्य जन्तोः ॐ श्री साईराम ऐ आफर् मै हम्बल् प्रणाम्स् एट् भगवान्स् डिवैन् लोटस् फीट् अवर् डियर् वेदमाता सत्यसाई माता रिस्पेक्टेड् एल्डर्स् Dear brothers and sisters who are on the path of Vedadhyayana, I take this opportunity to thank the organizers of Sri Satya Sai Samyukta Shruti Shreni of our Sri Satya Sai Seva organizations. I also thank the organizers like Subramanyam Gorti Garu, Dr. Ratish Kumar, and all the people, the team, which is making this possible. I'm very happy to note that so many of our brothers and sisters across India and other countries too have enrolled for learning of these Veda mantras, which are very foundations of not only the Indian culture, but the culture of the humanity itself. You have heard in these talks eminent speakers like Brother Sudhindran and Dr. Anil Kumar on various aspects of Vedas, how they form the very foundations of our Indian culture. They have mentioned that Vedas are infinite. Ananto vai Vedaha. They are apaurisheya, not originated from man. And various branches of Vedas were also covered. An exposure was given to all of us. They have also mentioned the potency of mere chanting of these Vedic mantras with sincerity and Shraddha. Even if you are not fully aware of the meaning, the mere chanting itself gives so many beneficial effects. Vedas are common treasure of divine wisdom available for the entire humanity. Since these are not fully realized by today's people, Bhagwan, in his infinite mercy, started this Vedic mission, this Vedodharana, the revival of Vedic culture and Vedas. Under this auspices of this very noble ideal, we are all learning Vedas as a part of Sri Satya Sai Samyukta Shruti Shreni. My introduction to Vedas was through a summer course which Bhagwan organized in 1977 on Indian culture and spirituality. During the summer, Bhagwan organized this summer course, and it was a month-long summer course for the students of Vrindavan campus and also select students from various states of India. The Sri Satya Sai Seva organization has selected people and then sent them to Vrindavan. And it was a month-long summer course wherein Swami invited great Vedic pandits, great people of eminence to expose us to the rich cultural heritage and spirituality of our country. I was then doing my pre-university class, though I did not understand all that they have mentioned that time, but it created a taste for these things. And I learned Vedas then with the sole purpose of going near to Bhagwan. Because as Vedam students, we were given an opportunity to go close to him, and then Swami gives us an opportunity to chant Vedam in his divine presence. Since my brothers had covered various aspects of Vedas, today I would like to introduce some truths which I have learned from the stories from the Upanishads, which I have learned from Bhagwan. Upanishads are also called Vedantas, the end of the Vedas. We have seen earlier that Vedas are divided into four parts, the Samhitas, the Mantras part, Brahmanas, Aranyakas, and Upanishads, the Karma Kanda, Upasana Kanda, and Jnana Kanda. Upanishads belong to the Jnana Kanda part of it. Vedanam ante asti Vedantaha, they say. So the very last portion of this Veda is the Vedanta, or the Upanishads. And it really contains the quintessence of the entire Vedas itself. Talking about Upanishads, Bhagavan mentions the very definition of the Upanishad. Upa, Ni, and Shat. Upa and Ni are actually prefixes, upasargas. They mean the near and down. Upa means near, Ni means down or lower, under. So we approach the Guru for the knowledge, Shat meaning sitting. We go near to the Guru, sit down to receive the knowledge. Swami explains this beautifully, in great detail. Why do we have to go near to learn? Now we have, online mode nowadays. Near or closeness is indicative of the importance we give. Now, whenever we want to tell them, congratulating them, or, tell something very, very important, we go near. It's indicative of our love and the warmth we have for them. When the Guru is trying to teach the lofty things of life, which are the very essence of Upanishads, the very purpose of our life and existence, we need to be close to him. We need to go close and then listen to him intently with a prayerful attitude and with humility. The master has a different level of experience and the student is at a different level with his limited experience. Either the student has to raise himself to the level of the master, or the master has to come down to the level of the student so that he can impart these lessons of life. Thus, sitting together closely, they chant the first mantra. Om Sahana Vavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvi Navadhitamastu, Mavidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Saha, together now, both of us, all together, avatu, may he protect us together. Both the teacher and the taught pray to the Lord to protect them. Sahanau bhunaktu, may we be nourished or energized together in our studies. Saha viryam karavavahai, karavavahai, may our study fill us with brilliance. Tejasvi navadhitamastu, may our study fill us with brilliance. Saha viryam karavavahai, meaning may we together perform. Ma vidvishavahai, may there be no enmity, differences of opinion. Swami in his chaste Telugu beautifully translates the same, you know, the import of this great Ved mantra in his own inimitable style. Say, kalasi melasi perugudam, kalasi melasi tirugudam, kalasi melasi kalata leka chelimito jeevinchudam. That let us live together, let us grow together, let us learn together. And then we chant Om Shanti 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 3 times. But Swami goes to great length to explain the, you know, meaning of chanting 3 times the peace to Adi Bhautika level of existence, Adi Daivika, the mental level, and Adhyatmika, the spiritual level. Only when we are at peace with our body, don't have any, you know, discomfiture, and when we are peaceful in our mind, then only we can understand and receive the great knowledge which the Upanishads teach us. So the Guru and Sishya sit together and pray to study and progress, for the progress together. There are many Upanishads. Some say 1008 Upanishads, but 10 of them are the most important Upanishads, called principal Upanishads. Shankaracharya, the great Acharya, has written commentaries on them. They are the 10 Upanishads, which are quite famous, are the Ishavasya Upanishad, Kena Upanishad, Kathopanishad, Prashnopanishad, Mundaka Upanishad, Mandukya Upanishad, Taittiriya Upanishad, Aitariya Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad, and Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. The Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is the biggest of these 10, and then the Mandukya Upanishad is the shortest with just 12 verses. As we mentioned, that Upanishads are very, in a quintessence, it contains a quintessence of the Vedas and all the spiritual lore of Indian culture. Once in an interaction with Bhagwan in the interview room, Swami was talking about Vedas, and then he was telling about the Upanishads and then the importance of them. And then Swami often gives time to ask questions. Then one student very humbly asked Swami, you know, Swami, if Upanishads are the very ultimate knowledge, the Jnana Kanda, what is the purpose of this Karma Kanda or the Upasana Kanda? What is the need for them? Because ultimately, the Jnana Kanda, the Jnana alone makes us realize him. So what is the reason behind having even these two other Kandas? Swami again comes down to the level of a student and explains to him with a beautiful example. He says, a child has come to you for learning. You want to teach the child. If you ask him to sit quietly, he will not be able to do it. Because, you know, it's not the nature of the children to sit quietly. They'll keep doing this thing or that thing, and they keep moving around, jumping around. It's the very nature of the small children. He says, if you have to teach him, you know, you have to ensure that, you know, he sits quietly. So if you ask him to sit quietly, just that time, he will not do that. What you ask him to just run around the house 10 times and come back. And then he does that joyfully. And then after comes back, even without your asking, he sits quietly. He says, similarly, our manas, our mind is wavering. Constantly it wavers. It is the very nature of the mind to waver. That's what Swami says. He says, very difficult to control. Swami talks about the mind in so many, many ways. At the same time, that very mind is helpful for us to learn and then to progress. So, Swami beautifully connects this one and says, to keep your mind alert and engaged and through the Karma Kanda, and calm it down through the Upasana Kanda, then you are ready to receive the highest knowledge, which is the Vidhi Vedanta Sara, which the Upanishads enshrine. So beautifully Swami connects this, you know, even though it is the very essence of Vedas, the end of the Vedas, it occurs. We do, Swami says, as a sadhaka, one goes through all these stages so that you enjoy and derive the maximum benefit from the teachings of the Upanishads. Like all masters, Bhagwan was teaching us the esoteric and profound Vedantic truths in simple story form so that we, the students, could understand and appreciate. You know, as I was thinking, why stories? I mean, why do they use the medium of stories to convey the profound truths? You know, when somebody says, I do not believe your stories, you know, when somebody is talking, he says, no, I don't believe your story. What do we mean by that? That is, you know, they may be, you know, glorifying, they may not be true. That's why he says, I don't believe your stories. But that is sometimes. At another time, we say, please sit, I will tell you my life story. And then you are all attention. Tell the story of civilization, the philosophy, the very, you know, our civilization itself progressed through this medium of stories. And the masters, our Lord, uses these stories, chinnakathas, as he calls them, to drive home the profoundest of the truths in the simplest manner so that we all can understand it. When Upanishads are telling the story, we need to be careful because they are telling something that cannot be conveyed in words. As Swami says, seto vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. They are beyond all of them, beyond the expression of the word and even the thought and the very manas, beyond the mind itself. In fact, Keno Upanishad says, Edvachana yadyudiktam ena vagjukchate tadeva brahmam what no speech can express, but what expresses the speech, know that that alone is Brahman, not the one which we worship as Chaturmukha Brahma. In fact, Swami distinguishes this. He said the Brahman which is talked in the Upanishadic lore is not the Chaturmukha Brahma, Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara, the trio deities which we worship. He says it is beyond all of them and then contains all of them. And Swami also gives a beautiful analogy for this, giving this chinna kathas. They are in Sanskrit called guda chikitsika, meaning the jaggery treatment. They say a spoonful of sugar makes the medicine go down. Okay, you coat it with a sugar coating so that the bitter pill of the medicine neatly goes down and even children can enjoy that. So these stories encapsulate the highest truth in a manner which is really enjoyable and palatable. Swami does this very often, and then let me recall one such story which Bhagwan used to narrate from Kathopanishad, the story of Nachiketa. Nachiketa was a young boy. He was the son of the Rishi Vajashravas. Vajashravas performs a fire yajna to propitiate gods, and at the end of the yajna, they give dana. They give, in charity, they give a lot of gifts. And Vajashravas, the Rishi Vajashravas, was giving away the cows to all the people and Brahmins who had come as a part of the charity. The young Nachiketa, standing beside his father, was watching all this, and then he was a little perplexed because his father was gifting very lean cows which do not yield milk and practically useless. So he was wondering. He says, no, this is not correct. What would this be useful for the people who receive them? And he had that internal churning. He felt that this danam is for pleasing God, and how is it my father is giving such old and then emaciated cows? At this point, I'll just take a detour and then tell one more experience of mine in a similar predicament which I was in. It was Gujarat earthquake time. Some of you may know that on 26th January, our Republic Day, India's 52nd Republic Day, morning 8:46, there was a huge earthquake in Gujarat, the regions of Kutch and Bhuj. Nearly 25,000 people died and many were rendered homeless, and a lot of misery was there. Swami sent our Sri Sat Sai from the Sri Sat Sai Seva organizations, Sevadals from all over the country, and they participated in the rescue and the relief program. They organized that. And we were in Parthi, and Swami was there also in Parthi. And then all the things were procured, and Bhagwan was telling us. The students of the hostel and then all the teachers, we also felt that we should also be a small part of this great yajna which Bhagwan is conducting the Seva Yagnam. And then we thought we will collect the clothes and then also collect a little bit of money. All the students were also very much wanted to do something or other because we cannot go because classes were going on. The semester was on. And then we should do something because Bhagwan is doing so many good things, and then some sevadals were being sent. So we thought, and the students came up and said that, sir, we will collect our clothes. Whoever can spare their extra clothes, they can be, collected and then washed and then ironed and then can be given from our side, our humble contribution, which we generally do, you know. Whenever there's somebody who's in need of it, we try to share things which we feel, okay, we have an extra and it's okay. We can take a new clothes and then, you know, this can be given away. They're good, but they're not brand new. And then I was the warden then. And then I thought it was a very good move from the students. And then so we went and placed our humble request to Bhagwan. Can we also bundle them together and then along with the, all the things which Bhagwan was sending to Gujarat, this also can be part of that. It was nearly coming to one load or so, all the school boys, institute boys, all of us together, we were wanting to do. And then Swami said, what are you giving? Then I mentioned this one. And then I got a good thrashing from Bhagwan. He said, are you all collecting old clothes to these Narayanas? I was taken aback. I didn't expect that answer. I said, Swami, no, students, I was trying to say, he said, no. These, you are serving these Narayanas. Service, when you do, is you are seeing the Narayana himself in the other person and then serving. He said, you are giving old clothes. If they have, give them the new clothes, not the old clothes. How beautifully Swami drove home. You know, the simple truth, when we are actually giving to somebody, the thought should be that you are not giving to somebody else. It is giving to, you are serving the Lord. And when we serve the Lord, the very best we give, not what we have eaten or what we have used, you know. So, vastam samarpayami, chamaram samarpayami, all that we say. Because now vastrade akshatam samarpayami, that's what we now very, conveniently give off, put some akshatas in lieu of a vastram. But Swami tells us, when we are serving others, serve them with the full knowledge that we are serving the Lord. In fact, we are serving ourselves. The big lesson for all of us was that we need to be extremely careful about serving the Lord who is present in everyone. So going back to the Nachiketa story, the young Nachiketa was pained to see his father giving these cows which were emaciated. So he goes to his father and pesters him, to whom will you give me? Father initially brushes him aside, but then he persists. He kept on asking his father, Father, whom will you give me to? Then in anger, father says, I give you to the Lord Yama. I am giving you to the Lord Yama. Young Nachiketa was not at all unhappy. He starts confidently to go towards the Yamaloka. As the story goes, the young Nachiketa, with the clear mind and confident of his fundamentals, he goes directly to the Yamaloka and then wanted to have the audience with Yama so that and say that I offer my services to you because my father has given to you, me to you. Unfortunately, Yama wasn't there. And then the Nachiketa had to wait for 3 days and three nights in front of the Yamapuri just to see Lord of Death, the Lord Yama. And then Lord Yama comes, and then when he finds that, learns that this Nachiketa, the boy Nachiketa, was waiting for him for 3 days without food and water, he felt very sad. In our Indian tradition, again, Atithi Devo Bhava, Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava, Acharya Devo Bhava, Atithi Devo Bhava, Swami says in Taittiriya Upanishad, you know, you have the end, Sikshavali, it comes. Atithi Devo Bhava. So we treat the Atithi, the one, Atithi, the definition is Thithi, the one who comes without Antithi and Vara and Nakshatra. You know, whenever we start, you know, in the Indian tradition, you see which is Atithi, is it Ekadasi, it's not Ashtami, no? And all that we see and then start. So one Atithi is, the guest is the one who comes without seeing any of them. And he is nothing but the form of God. That's what our tradition says. And then we need to respect that. So the Yama finds that a young Brahmin boy was waiting for him for 3 days. He was very, very pleased. And then he felt sorry for him. And then said, oh, boy Nachiketa, ask for 3 boons. Because you have waited for 3 full days for me. And then, you know, the conversation follows. The Nachiketa, first boon he asks is, let my father be peaceful and then do proper things and accept me when I go back. First is also not for himself, for his father, for parents, because Matru Devo Bhava, Pitru Devo Bhava. Let my father have the peace of mind and let him do correct things. That is the first wish, first boon grants him. Then it goes for the second one. He says, tell me the correct procedure of the fire, to do fire sacrifice. The Nachiketa Yagna, sometimes it is called, and then that too, Lord Yama grants, teaches him. Then the third boon, he says, I want to know the mystery of what comes after death. What goes away when the body falls? This is what Nachiketa wanted to learn from Lord Yama, the Lord of Death. Lord Yama was reluctant, because even he tried to dissuade Nachiketa, saying that even the gods are very uneasy about it, they are very confused about it. Why you want to learn this, such a very difficult subject? Ask for gold, ask for this and ask for that. He tries to give him something. But Nachiketa would not relent. He says, please give me that knowledge, what happens to us after death. And then when the Lord Yama asks, why didn't you take the, you know, luxuries of life? And then Nachiketa makes one very nice sentence in the Keno Upanishad. The Sarvendriyanam Jarayanti Tejaha. As we utilize the power of the indriyas, the senses, they are only going to deteriorate. They are only going to become weaker and weaker. So the pleasures deplete our energy and the vitality of my senses. So what is the use of learning and having these pleasures? But I want to have know that which makes me deathless. In this context, Swami also used to give a beautiful analogy. You know, body is a limited company. You know, all our organs are all limited company. Meaning, Swami says, your eyes, it can see only certain luminosity. Beyond that, automatically, our eyes get closed, the eyelids close. You know, our tongue can take only certain amount of heat. Okay, so all are limited company. So beyond our range, Swami says we should not do that because it harms the thing. So Nachiketa's persistence and perseverance pleases Yama, Lord Yama, and then teaches this atmic principle. He starts with the Omkara. Swami beautifully explains that significance of the Omkaram, which is the very symbol of Brahman. And then he is all pervasive, smaller than the smallest, bigger than the biggest, Anuraniyan, Mahato Mahiyan. And Swami also quotes very often this analogy, which is quoted in this Upanishad. The Emma teaches him, say, the famous analogy of Atmanam Rathanam Vidhi Shariram Rathamevacha Rathamevatu Buddhim Tu Sarathim Vidhi Manah Pragahamevacha Indrani. Coming down to the English translation of this one is Atmanam Rathanam Vidhi. He says the Atma, the soul inside us, is the owner, and Shariram Rathamevacha, our body is verily the chariot. And then Swami goes on to explain this Buddhincha Sarathim, that is the discriminative power one has. The Buddhi is the Sarathi or the charioteer. And then the horses or the senses, the mind is the whip which we use it. Indriyani and Vishayam Techu, the path is the desires which we have. And then he says, this is how you should understand that you are not the body. The body is only a ratham or the chariot. You are verily that Atman, the same atmic principle which is indestructible and which is eternal. So Swami very beautifully summarizes. He says, this is the very essence of this Upanishad. He says, no, O Nachiketa, this body is only a chariot. Atma alone is the owner. Once we have this thought trend that we are not the body, Swami gives various examples, and this is one such example which many of you may know, that Swami says, how he proves that we are not the body, we are verily the Atman itself. We are something different from the body. When we say, this is my hand is separate from myself. This is my kerchief, means kerchief is different from myself. So similarly, Swami says, it's only your body. You are not the body itself. You are just enshrined in this body. You are the Atman. So Swami beautifully drives home using the Nachiketa story, the very essence of Upanishad, that you are nothing but the very atmic principle. Anoraniyan Mahato Mahiyan Atma Guhayan Nihitosya Jantoho. Narayana Upanishad says that Anoraniyan, and he is the smaller than the smallest and bigger than the biggest. He is enshrined in the very heart of our this thing. This is only one katha or one story which I had taken already. It's time up. Swami gives beautiful stories of this nature from the Upanishads to drive home the very, very, difficult truths of Vedanta in very, very simple form. Since the time is running short, I would stop here. We only need to realize by chanting Vedas, the chanting Vedic mantras, our mind gets prepared to receive this knowledge, the knowledge supreme, which Bhagwan has come here to make us realize. It is there, the knowledge is there with us. It's just that Swami removes that veil, veil that which covers this knowledge, as Swami says, avarana vikshepa. When we remove, or when we actually come to the knowledge of this, or when we know about this knowledge, automatically we derive the bliss. Swami very beautifully gives this example, and with that I stop. He says, what is the difference between the person who knows swimming and who does not know swimming? The person who knows swimming does not have a web like ducks between their fingers. He does not have wings to help him to, you know, swim. And so what is the difference between the two? Both are people, not normal, ordinary people. The only difference is the person who knows swimming knows that he knows. He knows the technique of swimming. And the person who does not know has to be taught that technique. And Swami says, so it is we are all the very form of the divine. We are the sparks of divine. It's just that we do not know, whereas some people are aware of it. These Mahatmas are aware of it. And Swami, the avatar of the age, has come here to just make us realize that we are this Atmic principle. Please realize it. He does it through various means. And I'm happy that Sri Satya Sai Samyukta Shruti Shreni is one such opportunity Bhagwan has presented to all of us to learn this Vedic wisdom. I pray to this Veda Mata, our Satya Sai Mata, to grant us that wisdom to understand these subtle truths of Vedas, which are beautifully expressed in his divine discourses. May Bhagwan's blessings be on all of us. Sai Ram.
Om Sri Sai Ram. At the very outset, it's once again my great privilege to thank Professor Shivashankar Sai for such a wonderful exposition. He took us back to the divine presence. He took us back to begin with. He started with the importance of Vedas and took us back to 1977 summer course. The way Swami has explained the essence, quintessence of all the Vedas to Upanishads, Professor Shivashankar Sai has nicely brought all the essence and tried to relate some of it to us through the Upanishadic stories. The very important point which Professor Shivashankar Sai was highlighting, the importance of stories. Upanishad, what is the need for an Upanishad? Upa, when you come there, the attitude of the love that brings them together, that reverence. So that he has highlighted very nicely. And we should remember the Upanishad, why it becomes a quintessence, is because binding the love between the student and the teacher, which makes the students to absorb and the teacher to transmit. It's a love that is flowing through between them. The essence he has very nicely brought us. We are very thankful to you, sir, for reminding us of such an important aspect of Upanishadic stories. And you also have told the importance through the way that Swami's narration of how a child is slowly made to lose its wavering and sit quiet. A very nice story, how it helps the way the importance of Upanishad helps us to stabilize and to stay, to absorb the essence of quintessence. For that, we need the stability and the way the story of Upanishads is going to give that strength and the stability for a child, a wavering mind. As you rightly mentioned, a child and a wavering mind, how it becomes stable. This is very thankful to you. So next time listen to Upanishadic stories, definitely I'm sure that we'll be doubly absorbed to get our wavering mind to steadiness. These stories do help us. And the importance of the Chinnakathas. The Swami has a very good chikitsa. Very nicely you put it, good chikitsa. You reminded us these good chikitsas, which is a very nice, or people also called as a small treatments, as you rightly put it, is a good chikitsa, the Jaggery treatment, as you rightly put it. So this helps us. This is a very small thing. It appears to be a small thing, but it's the right thing which would help the people with a wavering mind to get stable and then get cured. You very nicely explained to us this wonderful experience. And when you were explaining the story of Nachiket, which is a very, very involved and a deep story, the essence of the Upanishadic story, Nachiketa, which is always, many of us find it to be very tough. You brought the quintessence of it very nicely. Some of the important messages, which very well goes with our Indian culture and spirituality, you brought it out in a very simple way, the way Swami has explained. So firstly, when you mentioned about Nachiketa observing his father giving an offering, lean cows and emaciated cows, and he tries to intervene and request his father to explain. And then when the father offers Nachiketa to Yamadharma Raja, you reminded us, yes, Pitru Devo Bhavat. Nachiketa did not turn back and run away, that he was offered to Yamadharma Raja, just as we have the story of Lord Rama who followed Dasharatha. You reminded us, this is not just with Rama, it has been there from ancient days. You have very nicely brought it out and reminding us one such very important episode is, again, you go back not only Rama, but our entire spirituality, our entire, a lot of stories, just not Ramayana and Mahabharata, Nachiketa story, he reminded us. The way he goes to Yamadharma Raja and offers himself and get the three boons. When he asked for the three boons, he reminded us, first he placed his father. That's the very part of the Indian culture and spirituality. First he placed others. Then he asked for setting right his father. Thanks for reminding us that that has been our culture and that is what we should be imbibing. Matru Deva Bhava, Pitru Deva Bhava, the way it has been, very nicely it has been explained through this story. And thanks again for sharing the wonderful experience of Swami, the wonderful lesson Swami has given to all of us. When you asked about the Seva activity contribution from the alumni student side, yes, I think help our hurt never, help ever. You have very nicely said, this is help means, what is the meaning of the help? What is the complete feeling of help that you have, the way Swami has blessed us? That lesson you have conveyed very nicely. Thank you very much, sir. Whenever we do a seva, we now will be doubly be careful that we are verily serving the God. These little examples always get entrenched, they go with us all along to keep us on the right track. Thanks for reminding us on such a wonderful lesson. Help ever, the way you help, just not blindly helping it, you are helping verily God. So this, the way we have to help, it has been very, the way Swami told you, convey to us. Thank you very much for this. And when he, you also talked about how the Nachiketa, when he asked for the boons, the third boon, when Lord Yama asked him to for any luxuries to be asked, but he said that, everything is, yeah, they are impermanent and they make weaken the body. What is more permanent? That's what we should be doing. The atmic principle, the highlights of the atmic principle, the way you gave us, where you brought home through the Omkara and the significance. Yes, thank you very much for this. And the way you have related the Atma being the soul being the owner of this chariot body. So thanks. This is all conveyed through this Upanishadic story and the power of the Upanishadic stories and the essence of Indian culture and spirituality, which has been nicely brought out through these few words. We're extremely thankful for you for this wonderful sharing of your learning, sir. With this, we offer our prayerful salutations once again to Bhagwan for bringing us all together through this satsang. Thank you very much, sir. We look forward for our next episode. Sai Ram.
Sai Ram.
ॐ जय जगदीश हरे स्वामी सत्य साई हरे भक्त जना संरक्षक भक्त जना संरक्षक पति महेश्वरा ॐ जय जगदीश हरे शशि वदना श्रीतरा सर्वा प्राणपति स्व स्वामी सर्वा प्राणपते आश्रित कल्पलतीका आश्रित कल्पलतीका आपकांधवा ॐ जय जगदीश रे माता पिता गुरु दैवम मरियंतयु नीवे स्वामी मरियंतयु नीवे नाद ब्रह्म जगन्नाथ नाद ब्रह्म जगन्नाथ नागेन्द्राशयना ॐ जय जगदीश रे ओंकार रूप ओजस्वी हो साई महादेवा सत्य साई महादेवा मंगल आरती अंधुको मंगल आरती अंधुको मंदर गिरिधारी ओम जय जगदीश रे नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण 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 ओम नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण नारायण ओम जय सद्गुरुदेवा नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण 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 ओम नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण नारायण ओम जय सद्गुरुदेवा नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण 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 ओम नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण नारायण ओम सत्य नारायण नारायण
ॐ